everyone, this is Izzy, the founder of the blog and YouTube channel, A Girl's Two Sound Sense. You are currently listening to Sounding Out, the podcast where I speak to friends, from musicians to producers to zine makers and promoters, about their experiences as women and queer femme people in the music industry. As always, please don't forget to give the podcast a rating and review on Apple Podcasts. It would be super helpful to help more people hear the podcast, and it will also get me recommended on streaming platforms. Today, I am so excited to be joined by Dr. Jennifer Otter Bickerdike, a multi-hyphenate legend and a familiar name in pop culture. Jen is a rock and roll cultural historian, academic professor, and the author of several best-selling books, including Why Vinyl Matters, The Secular Religion of Fandom, You Are Beautiful and You Are Alone, The Biography of Nico, and most recently Being Britney, Pieces of a Modern Icon, which is now available for pre-order and will be available in stores on November 11th via 9/8 Books Publishing. Jen has quite the unique story. She started out as a marketing rep for Sony, Geffen Records, and Interscope Records. In 2001, she decided to drop everything, moved to London from Santa Cruz, and got her PhD. She now works as a professor of popular music for one of the largest institutes for creative arts education in Europe. In 2013, she won the coveted Student-Led Teaching Award for Most Innovative Lecturer, and was also shortlisted for the same accolade on a national level by the Times Higher Education. In our conversation, Jen and I covered a wide range of topics. We discussed the best Britney album of all time, gush over Shirley Manson from Garbage, unpack how Jen pieced together a long breadcrumb trail in order to accurately report on Nico's life story in her Nico biography, and we also discuss how a conversation with Henry Rollins inspired Jen to become a full-time writer. Getting to have this conversation was quite a big deal for me, as Jen has been one of my number one inspirations since I started writing about music in college, and I thoroughly enjoyed her company. But before we get into this episode, I would like to remind my listeners that I am paying for the podcast out of pocket, so if you would like to help me make more episodes, and maybe help buy me a copy, then head on over to my Patreon for unedited episodes of the podcast and more chill conversations with guests outside of the interview process. Those who join my Patreon will get access to patron-only video essays and exclusive voting power for future artists that I cover on my YouTube channel as well. So head on over to patreon.com/agirls2soundsense, that's girl with three R's, to subscribe. And without further ado, let's get right into this episode.
Hey, girl!
Hey! What's up?
I'm so sorry. I'm shoving food in my face really quickly. It's just been one of those fucking days where, like, I have had no time to do anything. Do I have time to eat this apple really quick before we get going? Is that okay?
Go ahead. Go ahead. Of course. Excuse me. I apologize for messing up the times.
You're just excited. It's all good.
Yeah.
Lizzie's just hardcore. That's all.
No. The reason why I guess I logged on early was just to make sure I didn't mess up the times, because the last time I had to meet with somebody who was in the UK, based in the UK, I messed up the time and was late.
Something like that happened to me. I did do an interview in Australia. I got the times wrong, and I ended up, they called me in the middle of the night, because I got the day and everything wrong. I ended up doing the fucking interview, they sent me a thing going, you've not answered your call, you're on air in 7 minutes, and I, like, did fucking live TV dog, like, in my pajamas, so I totally get it, don't even worry about it.
Did you have a fun All Hallows Eve?
If you call taking my husband into the emergency dentist, yeah, it was fucking raging.
What happened to your husband's dental situation?
He is scared of the dentist. He's not been to the dentist, I kid you not, in 20 years. And he had a wisdom tooth that was fucked up. And so he waited till it was like so painful he could like not move. And then, yes, I was trying to make this, it looks good for you. Is this video, by the way, just a video podcast?
No, it's just going to be audio.
Okay, so then we'll worry about that then. Good. Okay, good. Sorry, I was like trying to make this look nice, but I won't. So it's just you and I. He just like, yeah, he's waited till it was like so unbearable that like he was in pain and couldn't do anything. So that ended up being yesterday. So that's what we did. Just went to the emergency dentist. What did you do? Did you do anything fun?
Fabulous. So actually funny. I do this thing every year where I challenge myself to find out who I can emulate out of an assortment of clothes that I already have in my closet.
Oh, I love that.
And so I have a picture here.
Yeah, you have to show me.
I was Nikolai from The Strokes.
Oh my God, I love that. That's so good. I love how you even, you're like, you know what? This clothing combination equals Nikolai from The Strokes. Like, who would even think that, by the way? Like, that's the most brilliant part about it is you're like, it's Nikolai. Hello. Like, this is clearly Nikolai.
Yeah. Wanted to ask you, what's your favorite Britney album of all time?
Okay, so my favorite Britney album is Blackout. I think it's completely underrated, and if anyone but Britney Spears would have put that record out, it would be hailed as like genre breaking classic genius. I think now people are starting to come around to it, but that record is just so badass in every single way. And the fact it's Britney Spears being like, I'm going to dip into all these different sounds and different producers and different people to have on the record makes it that much more brave and crazy and cool, and shows one thing that Britney, I think, never gets the love for that she deserves is being an artist herself. That was something that really came out when I was working on the book, is that people seem to always think, well, you know, she's this manufactured person. Britney is an artist. And if they could have made another Britney Spears, they being the corporate music machine, they would have. They've tried. There's only one Britney Spears. And I think Blackout is a great example of how unique and wonderful and talented she is as a creator.
Agreed. That's also is that my good? Favorite album.
Yeah, girl. So yeah, Blackout, I think, is a great example of that. And just even her, and everything about that record, not just the music, but the cover photos, I think are cool. The ends, if you open it up, her with the priest, it is totally like an homage to Madonna. Oh, but yeah. I like that about it because it's like her saying, you know what? I'm going to push the boundaries of stuff. I'm going to make you question everything. And I love that about it. I love that about Britney. I'm not going to be your good little girl that you want me to be anymore. I'm going to try to explore who I am. And I think that Blackout is such a great example of that.
I agree. Yeah. All the and I love, you can tell that they were just kind of tinkering around with that album, and all the producers she worked with were amazing. Like the Neptunes, Bloodshy and Avon and all those people. And the fact that she made this super abrasive, that album was so ahead of its time. When you listen to Charlie XCX, Hyperpop Now, and even some power electronics, like, I don't know, freaking Pharmacon or something, I'm always like, this sounds like Blackout. It's so underrated, you're right.
And also, I think, again, like, this is the thing, like, I got my first review Sunday, I got my first review for the Britney book, and this is the huge thing about Britney that just drives me absolutely insane is show me another artist that has the cultural impact of Britney Spears, probably since Elvis and the Beatles. Like, you're going to be hard pressed to show me someone that's had the staying power, that's had, if we just take the person Britney Spears out, the brand and the impact of Britney, you know, look at her perfume empire. Look how she's transformed Vegas. Look how she transcends presidents. She transcends the era from brick and mortar stores to the digital time we're in now. There's no one else like that. And yet the thing that's so absolutely frustrating to me is that people still seem to not take her seriously, like as a businesswoman, as a creator. And that drives me absolutely crazy. Like, I just don't understand like what it is about it. I don't know if it's that she's a woman. I don't know if it's that she's from the South. I don't know if it's the kind of music she makes. But the different points that you're making about that particular record really show that even at her lowest point in her personal life, she still was able to kind of cobble together this pastiche of different people that were interesting and look ahead into the future of what was going to be, of what was going to be the, you know, the forebears of music to come and put them all onto one album. It's just absolutely incredible, that record. And I just, that's one of the things that was so important to me about writing this book, is that I didn't want to be like, Britney, you're the bestest. I had to be somewhat objective. Britney is a flawed human being. But the reason that writing this book was so important to me was that I had to be like, okay, let's look at the person, but then let's also look at the sociological, cultural, and economical impact Britney Spears has had. And it's completely unique to anyone else. You cannot, I mean, like I said, maybe the Beatles and maybe Elvis in terms of the way that they've changed culture. There's no other person like Britney Spears. I would say even Madonna, she's surpassed Madonna in terms of like the perfume and the different other kind of things that she's gone spun off into.
Yeah, I fully agree. And I'm so glad that you wrote the book from that perspective of somebody who is who understands the importance of objectivity and nuance, but also giving this woman her due and her flowers, which are way overdue, if you ask me. And also, I was going to say another thing, but oh yeah, I love those memes where it's just where it says Britney could write Yellow Submarine, but the Beatles couldn't write Toxic.
Well, yeah. I mean, the one thing that is interesting is I sent the book, I'm friends with Henry Rollins, who's like an iconic punk. Amazing writer, amazing stand-up, just a great human being in general. And what he said to me, he said, what this book shows is how much America and the media hates women. And it's really, really true, because I think it's really a damning, I'm American, I live in Britain, but it's a damning of America and the way that we also export our values to the rest of the world. But the way that Britney has been treated, I mean, I cannot believe that she's still alive, to be fair. Like, I probably would have killed myself, you know what I mean? And I think it shows how absolutely strong and amazing and just what a survivor. That word is used a lot and overly used, but it shows what this, there's this rod of strength going through that woman that is just, you have got to take your hat off and praise her for it, because the way that she's been treated is just unbearable. Like, I can't think of anyone else that would be able to have survived that, to be fair. Like, it's incredible. And that was really what I wanted to show in this book, is this evolution of a person and almost the lack of evolution in a lot of ways of the way that women are treated. And that it takes, there's a part at the end of the book, the way that the book is made is it's in 40 different, because it's going to be Britney's 40th birthday, December 2nd, and it's made into 40 short chapters. So it goes timeline-wise through Britney's life, but like 40 little different episodes and stories about her life. And it's really about how Britney is a cultural touch point to all these different different things that happen. So for example, one of the ones that I thought was my favorite to write, because it was so disturbing, was when Britney goes and has the testimony on June 23rd in court about how her father and the conservatorship is still controlling her body in so many ways, especially how she has to have the IUD to control her getting pregnant or not. And that to me just had complete and utter Handmaid's Tale type stuff all over it. And it started making me look at the fact that in America, there is still laws that there's laws that can make women sterile still in America. You look at Texas, what's happening with the right to choose laws. Yeah. And the fact that it takes Britney, this is the thing that kind of is interesting to me. It takes Britney Spears talking about it for us to talk about it as a society. But then if you look at what's the news about Britney now, I think what's really sad is instead of focusing on her as a touch point for change, it's like, oh, well, Britney called Sam her boyfriend instead of her fiance, or, oh, Britney's abs. It's like, why don't we look at Britney as this provocateur of change and empowerment? Why are we going right back to like just her as a as just an avatar and the way she looks, instead of her as this person that is a really great role model for people. And that I think is very, very frustrating. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Oh, of course. Yeah. It's aggravating to even think about, you know. And you said you wrote something similar in your Joy Devotion book about how the news of Amy Winehouse.
You're so cute that you even know that book.
I like to do research. It's one of my favorite pastimes. That's not even a joke. It seriously is. But you say something similar in that book about Amy Winehouse and how her passing just overshadowed and glossed over all the other atrocities going on the planet, and how tragic that really is when you really think about it. And a lot of it was also glorifying and almost romanticizing her plight because she was part of the 27 Club, which that's like, I don't even want to open that Pandora's box, but you know, I enjoy how you write about this stuff from a very critical and very academic, scholarly viewpoint. And because that's exactly the way I think. And your work, I'm about to go off on a fangirl tangent here, but
you can go off on that as much as you want.
But that's why your work really inspired me, because I would see you as a talking head in some of these rock docs, and that was how I found your books. And I was wondering if you would be interested in talking about how you initially started out as someone who did marketing for major artists and then decided to make a left turn or start a new chapter and move to London and focus more on your writing. Would you be interested in telling me a little about that?
Yeah, of course. I mean, first of all, it's very, very kind of you to say that. And I literally, one of my idols is Shirley Manson from Garbage. And I just was telling her last night that what's so frustrating is that a big part of what I do is because I want to show young women like you that, like, you can write, you can have a voice, you can make change in the world. I want to be a role model. I want to inspire other young women. And I want to inspire women my own age. You know, I'm 49 years old. And I think we're really told that if your dream doesn't happen by the time you're 25 or 30, that you're like on the garbage pile. You know what I mean? Like, you can reinvent and keep figuring out who you are until you are dead, basically. Like, there's no time stamp on changing and evolving who you are. It's like, you put that on yourself. But I was saying to Shirley last night is that I just am like, how it's hard to put yourself out there. And like, how just hearing you say that makes me feel really good, because it's difficult to put yourself out there over and over and over again. Because when you put, every time you put yourself out in the world, you're allowing yourself to be open for criticism, people that don't understand, and I've been trolled and this, that, and the other. So to hear that from you makes me feel really, really good. So thank you very much for saying that.
Of course.
But what I did is when I went to Olympic trials for swimming when I was 16, and that was what I thought I really, really, really wanted to do. And then I didn't make it. I came in fourth and they took the top three people. And I was just like, what? That's my whole identity, is swimming. But what swimming did is it trained me to be like, and I actually went swimming the other day. I had not been swimming in probably a year plus, but I realized that like what swimming does is it's like, that's the goal, whether it's like, this is the workout you have for that day or you're training for this event. And it just allowed me to have this, my boss calls it like, you just show me what the goal is. You wind me up and I just go for it. And that's kind of my way of doing things. Like if I have the plan, I'll go for it. So the next thing I did is I'm like, what am I into? I'm super into music. Like I started putting on shows in my hometown of Santa Cruz. When I went away to uni, I got a job. I got picked out of 300 people to be the college rep for Sony. So you can imagine this is like the early 90s. So I was driving Pearl Jam around. I was hanging out with Nirvana. It's like your dream if you're like a kid, especially at that time period. You know what I mean? That's how I got started. And then I eventually decided, is this too much detail or is this good?
No, keep going.
At the time, the really cool record label to work for was Interscope Records. It had just really, like, it had Jimmy Iovine, it had Dr. Dre, it just had all these interesting artists, and it was really, really about artists. And so I literally told the head of marketing at Interscope, I said, I want to work here, whatever it takes. So I started sending her all of my stuff, like, even though I wasn't even working at Interscope, I started sending her like all of the random stuff I was doing at another record label. And when I was 24, they hired me to be the West Coast marketing director. So that's how I got that job. And I did that. I did that, and I worked at Interscope for about 8 years. I did that, and then I left to go help Gwen Stefani start her handbag line. And then this is the part that people never ask me about, like, I broke my arm, and I couldn't work for Gwen anymore. And in America, they don't have health insurance. So suddenly, I went from having this very, very glamorous lifestyle and job, having an expense account, to I'm completely unemployed. I have a huge hospital bill, and I could not get employed anywhere. Like, I was applying to be like a toilet, like a toilet attendant at posh nightclubs, and they wouldn't hire me because they're looking at my resume going, head of marketing, Interscope Records, Gwen Stefani, and now you want to be a toilet assistant? Like, I don't think so. Like, I remember going to Banana Republic, the clothing store. I'm trying to be a sales associate, and they're like, no. Like, I could not get hired anywhere. So I went from like being this really like aspirational job to like could not get hired to work in a bathroom, literally. And at that point, I just was like, what am I doing? So I went back to get my master's. I started a master's at San Francisco State, and I did that and eventually decided to get my PhD. And the way that I ended up moving to London was I was working at Facebook. So eventually I did get a job. I was working at Facebook, getting my master's, and one of my friends I'd grown up with was murdered not far from my house in San Francisco. And after that, I was just like, life is too short to be like, to be working constantly. And so I sold everything I own and I moved here to get a PhD because I'd always wanted to live in England. And that's how I ended up here. That's the very long version of it. Was that too? That's probably too long. Feel free to edit
No,
that
no, no,
down.
no, no, no. Yeah, that's. I'm really glad that you mentioned the fact that you str people struggle to get to where they are, and it isn't easy, even if you start out doing something that seems like your dream, and you're totally right. I've just graduated college and now I'm going through an existential crisis every day.
Of course.
Who am I? What do I want? What is life? And
Have you seen The
it's,
Graduate by with Dustin Hoffman?
yeah.
That part where he like just jumps in the pool and he goes to the bottom and he's just like, what the fuck am I doing with my life? Like, that is just like, and I think that even now, like with kids your age, I think nothing really, there still is this expectation that like at 25, this and this is going to be set up for you. At 30, this and this, even if like everybody's like, oh, at 30, nobody's married, nobody has kids, nobody owns a house, I still think there is this societal expectation that some of these kind of goalposts are going to be, you know what I mean? Like, you're going to have that. Like, if you go to Thanksgiving, you're probably what, 22 now? So if you go to Thanksgiving and like you don't have a partner, you're not sure what you're doing with your job, maybe this year it'll be okay. Next year, if you go, they'll be like, If you go, but by the time you're 25, if you're not like on some path that your family can understand, that's when shit will start going, okay, something, what's wrong? What's wrong here? You know what I mean? And that sucks because it's just like what you start, that's the societal expectation that your parents and your family also probably had drilled into them. It has nothing really to do with you or what's going to make you happy, you know? And that's what you have to kind of break out of. That part right there is what you need to try to figure out. Like, what's going to make me happy? Whether it's, working at a donkey rescue place, or if it's traveling, or if it's being a badass podcaster, like whatever it is. And I think that's the hardest part is like tuning out that expectation and tuning into yourself.
Absolutely.
That's the hardest part though. Is to do that. And that's something that I have to do all the time now still is like, okay, like strip all of it away. What is really the most important thing to me? You know what I mean? And that most important thing can change as time goes by. Like, now when I think that, I'm like, what are the most important things to me? And I'm like, really the most important things, there's like personal and professional. Like personal, hanging out with my husband, hanging out with my dog, being able to go to the beach and swim and work out. And then professionally, it's like, if I have to have a job, it's like being an educator, being an advocate for women, being able to tell women's stories from like a new contextual viewpoint. Like those are the things that are important to me. And those, if I just kind of like keep focusing on that, then everything else kind of falls away. You know what I mean?
Absolutely. I love that. Another question I have is, when is the first time you can recall music transforming your life in a significant way?
I would say I've been into music since I was like 3 or 4 years old, but so it's always been very important to me. But when I was actually at university, I discovered the Smiths, and it was like no other band I'd ever heard before. It just, I'd always been into music, like I said, like since I was like a very young kid. But the Smiths, just something about the music, the lyrics, everything about it, the art, it captured the way I felt inside in a way that I couldn't express for myself. And I remember James Cramer gave me a tape that it was like a tape that something else had already been on. So there was like, you're listening to the tape of this, it was the Smiths, Strange Ways Here We Come. And there was like an echo of whatever had been on the tape before. So you kind of like hear it between songs, whatever was on the tape before. You hear random, like whatever it was. And then it'd be Strange Ways. And I remember I listened to that tape. Like I'd fall asleep listening to that tape. I'd wake up, listen to that tape, like 24/7 for the first probably like month. That's all I listened to. And like probably for the first year I discovered the Smiths, I would only listen to the Smiths. And sometimes I would take a break and be like, okay, I'm gonna take a break from the Smiths and I'm gonna listen to Morrissey, who's the lead singer from the Smiths. I'm gonna listen to some of his solo stuff. That was my taking a break from the Smiths. Or Johnny Marr, who's the guitarist for the Smiths. I'm gonna listen to some things Johnny Marr worked on. So that was like my complete obsession. And I can say hand on heart, I would have probably killed myself if it was not for the Smiths. Like, they were that important of a band to me. And it was funny because earlier this year, I got to interview Johnny Marr. And it was weird because it was like on Zoom, like it is right now with you and me. And here's someone that like his art just changed the trajectory of my life. Like I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for him. And he and I are just joking around, talking about, you know, making sourdough bread. I'm talking shit about different people we both know. And then I just am like, I mean, I'm sure he's heard it millions of times by now. I'm just like, you saved my life. And he's like, oh yeah, thank you very much. Because what is he going to say? But, you know, it's pretty intense, like what a band or a song can do for you, for sure. What was the what band has done that for you?
Good question. This is a super cliche answer, but I would say Nirvana. Mm. And I feel like that's true for a lot of other people. Mm-hmm. I watched the Kurt Cobain doc, Montage of Heck, when I was in high school, and that was when the first time I started really getting immersed in the contextual history and culture of a scene, or as they call it. But yeah, and also a lot of whole records too. I feel like Courtney, no matter what Courtney Love has done or said, I have to divorce the work from the person in that sense, because her music really pulled me from the rut there. I mean, I can't lie. I don't think I would have survived the hellish pits of girlhood if it wasn't for Live Through This. Mm-hmm.
I think a lot of people share that feeling about Courtney. So I understand that. Yeah. Well, that's cool. Yeah. I think Nirvana is an important band to a lot of people.
Definitely. And I love how they really sort of bust the door down for that sound at the time. No one believed that a band like that could be played on MTV. And that's just so fucking cool that they made it those heights, you know?
No, absolutely. I mean, take Michael Jackson down too. It was crazy. Absolutely crazy. It's crazier now to me that the way that they've been memorialized is not how it was at that time, but that's a whole different podcast, girl. But yes, I love that you love Nirvana. That's really cool.
Yeah. I totally get what you're saying, though, about how a celebrity's image becomes mythologized after they die at a certain age. And then there's people cashing in on it and all that ugly stuff. But yeah, like you said, a whole other can of worms. And so I also wanted to mention that I really loved that story about Keith Ho Collins Hornchurch. Is that how you pronounce his name in the Britney book? I think that's a very heartwarming tale of how fandom to outsiders might seem silly, but we all have at least one person in our lives that we would follow to the end of the earth, someone who stands in place of this religious icon. I was chatting with Pat Flagel from Cindy Lee a few weeks ago, and one of the things they said to me was, I think celebrity worship is kind of dumb, but I can't help it. In the absence of God, we worship other people. And I thought that was very, very apt. And I know that you are also an unapologetic self-proclaimed fangirl, which I love. And I was wondering what you would say are some of the biggest similarities and discrepancies between fandom and religious worship.
I would say that they definitely hold the same place, especially now, because if we look at the attendance at traditional venues of religious worship, aka synagogues, mosques, and churches, especially synagogues and churches, the attendance in the Western world is dropping significantly. And if within America, for example, the certain different kinds of Christianity are going to be extinct in the next 30 years if the drop in participants continues the way at the rate that it's going right now. On the flip side of that, you have the way that we're connected via the internet. That is, of course, accelerating, going up and up and up and up and up. And what's happened is it's normalized now. You see this a lot on Twitter or on different social networking platforms where it's normalized now to have an obsession or to have a fixation on specific celebrities and to hold them in that same kind of place of worship that you would have previously held a more traditional sort of godlike figure. So, if you think about people, do people really? One of the things I talk about in the book is the show Chaotic that Britney Spears did with Kevin Federline in the early days of that relationship, and how that just got universally panned. Because one of the things about that show was that it was kind of like the real Britney, like it was Britney discovering her sexuality, Britney talking about her sexuality, Britney without all the stage costumes, Britney dressing like girls did at that moment. Britney being a young woman, and people did not want to see the real Britney, So I bring that up. People like that idealized version of Britney and the Britney that they can project themselves onto as well. So when you're looking at things that are similar, if we think about a God, because we can't interact in terms of we can't sit here and be like, so God, how's this outfit today? Or God, you have a big zit. Those kind of little kind of small things. It's that same sort of projection, and we can create God in an image that suits us in a lot of ways. And something that I write about in some of my other books, it's not in Britney, is the idea of kind of like a pick and mix or salad bar ideas of religion is something that's quite popular now, in that you kind of take what you want from Christianity or whatever, and you leave behind what doesn't suit you. So, for example, like I grew up in the Catholic Church, and like I'm 100% like pro-choice. I'm 100% any sexuality. I don't care. You know what I mean? So you could say, like, if you pushed me and said, okay, what religion are you? I probably would say Catholic, but I'm very much of that. I choose the things that it works for me. Like I like the pomp and circumstance of Catholicism. But I'm absolutely at a huge disagreement with some of the kind of still the beliefs in it. So in terms of answering your question, I think that one of the reasons we have people like Britney being so important to us is because they fill that void that traditional religion previously would have held for us.
Yeah, how you speak to Megan Radford and Kevin Wu and Free Britney LA, and mention Jordan Miller with his Britney blog and everything to fans. It's not a fucking joke. And that's what I really loved about the way you wrote about Britney, was that you come from a place where you have been that person who is a big fangirl and who does understand what it's like when these people care enough about someone they've never met to fight for their fundamental human rights.
I'm really happy that came across, because I mean the Free Britney thing is a weird one for me, because I both have so much admiration for them. I absolutely adore the Free Britney LA guys that I know, guys and gals I know. Love Megan Radford. Like, she lived in London. I've already told her, I'm all, bitch, please, if I move to where you are, girl, that best friend better move over, because I'm going to be in her place. But I think it's a hard one, because part of me is like, I understand, like, how, because there was a point in my life where if someone said, someone has Morrissey or Johnny Marr from The Smiths locked up, I'd be like, I'm going to go free that. Like, I would have been exactly the same way. You know what I mean? But the flip side of that is there's other things now that I think are so important that I'm like, why is this the most important thing to you? Like, there's so many other, to me, pressing issues. But that's me imposing what's important to me onto someone else. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. And I think because of what we just talked about, Britney to them has filled that role for them that something else has not. So therefore, she is that most important thing that you would go to, you would fight. People die for their religions for hundreds of thousands of years, the same sort of thing that they're talking about, you know? What's more troubling to me, I think, is the fact that the press keeps reverting back to this, like we're talking about, like, Britney looks hot in her red bikini. Well, let's talk about how Britney's been treated for the last 13 years. Let's talk about the fact that Britney's sexual rights have been in lockdown, and like, that, let's keep that conversation going it's kind of like we're reverted back to like the mid-2000s. That's really frustrating.
I hate the whole spectacle of it, where it's like, look how awful this is, what she revealed in her testimony, and then there's nothing after that, no follow-up.
Exactly.
We'll just go on with their day and forget about it.
Exactly. That's just it. Exactly. What was your favorite part of the Britney book?
The part about Keith, the fan who donated the collection to the museum in her hometown, Kentwood. Yeah,
it didn't make it into the book, but Keith was he was actually deaf.
Yeah,
there's like a sentence in there, I think, about it. But he was born deaf, and so the whole thing is like, we talk a little bit about it, but because of just time and stuff, he was deaf. And I think what's really interesting, and I hope it comes across the way that we did it in the book, is it's like Britney allowed him to become free. Like, Britney represented freedom to him. And I think him going to her concerts, him being into the whole Britney experience, was kind of, if you would, like, the entryway for him starting to do things on his own and busting out. So like, his sister-in-law and his brother were talking about how he went on all these trips and he was traveling, doing all this cool stuff. And Britney, I think, was the catalyst that allowed that to happen. And so, like, they were talking about, like, at his funeral, people were like, oh, the poor little deaf boy didn't get to live. Britney helped him live. And like, the horrible irony there is he was living as she's getting locked down, as she's not being allowed to live. And that's the horrible, like, beauty in, it's like beautiful in a tragic, horrible way. Like, she allows him to live just as she's not being allowed to live. And that part, I hope that comes across somewhat in the, what made it into the book. But yeah, that was his sister-in-law is great, as is his brother. They're beautiful people. And I was really honored that they spoke to me. So yeah. I'm glad that you liked that part.
Yeah, it was very touching. And I also feel like this is a good segue into my Nico question, because I absolutely adored that biography as well. And
oh, thank you.
I loved how it was very clear that you were willing to give her agency over her own voice back, because if there's one pattern I've noticed, which was really frustrating to witness over any retelling or biography of Nico over the past several decades, was that everyone was more than willing to allow her inner circle to speak for her, which was mostly men. And that was just something that really just, especially in that, in that Nico Icon documentary, I remember that snippet where her old friend, Carlos, was
who is he?
Yeah, she played this game of being a lesbian, or maybe she was genuinely attracted to women, Carlos, you know? But I loved how you were so passionate about giving her that agency, because especially since she's no longer alive to speak for herself, you know? And I was wondering what drove you to write about her in particular.
Well, thank you so much. I'm so happy that you love that book. That book was a lot of work to do. And the reason I wanted to do the book is exactly what you've pointed out here. And that is because, and actually to be the same thing with, this is something that Britney shares as well. It's men that have told the story of these two women. And I think regardless of what you say, there's just something about the experience of being a woman that you just, especially, I have to say this too, is that writing these two books back to back, and they have been back to back. Like, I started writing Britney and I was finishing editing Nico at the very same time. So it was pretty intense. It's just the amount of misogyny that we live with now, it just is shocking to me. It's been shocking in terms of writing these books, like writing how Nico was treated then, the way she was written about, the kind of interviews that you're talking about, the way people talked about her, the way people still talk about her. Like when I was getting reviews for the book, the way people would talk about the way that in reviews, people would talk about the way I wrote about Nico and Nico herself. I'm just like, are you kidding? Like I did this TV interview where I like got on the interview because it was on Zoom, and behind her, I'm like a little head on Zoom and they're like on a TV set. It was like world's biggest groupie. That was like what the headline was. And I'm like, I never would have gone on if I knew that was what it was going to say. And there were several different articles about the book that was mentioned throughout it. And I'm just like, they would never write that about a man. Like, it's just shocking to me. And I think I said this again to Shirley Manson in my email to her. I'm like, the amount of anger and this incandescent rage I've had over the last, I would say 4 years was when I started working on Nico, but building up to this point now where it's being reviewed and people aren't taking the time to really look and see what I'm trying to say. That is very difficult because we're living in this time where we're supposed to be able to talk about sexuality and gender and be more open. But I find like it's almost more misogynist, more rigid, more, you can't ask or question or be nice or kind to people. And I think with Nico, it was so important. It's like, let's give this woman the benefit of the doubt. Let's look at the context that she came up in. You know, let's see, like, why did she act this way? She wasn't just this racist German iceberg. Like, she had a very difficult life. I'm not excusing different things that she said or did, but I am saying try being born and raised in Nazi Germany and trying to figure that one out, which she was the rest of her life. And that was really important to me. And in terms of like the thing about her liking women or not liking women, I think only Nico could answer that question. And to have someone like Carlos, whatever his name is, I know exactly who you're talking about, try to answer that question. Why do we even listen to his story? Like, why is he even talking about it? You know? And in fact, there's tons of stuff that got cut out of the book because that book was twice as long initially. But there was a lot of stuff I wrote about. Actually, there was a rumor that she had an affair with Chanel. Mm. And it's just fascinating to look at the way that these powerful women, they have to, like, society, media, or just, I don't even know, those catty people, they have to shut these powerful women down somehow. And if that's like saying, oh, they're lesbian, so that's the way we're going to shut them down, that's bad. Or if it's belittling them, saying they're stupid, like all these things are supposedly seen as negative. We cannot allow a woman to be strong, smart, business savvy, dare we say good looking on top of that. Oh no, you know what I mean? Like, these things cannot go together.
They can't coexist. They can't possibly. Yeah. What?
Yeah. Exactly. That's just it. They cannot coexist. That's exactly it. So that's really what I wanted to do with that Nico book. And the fact that you as like a young woman's reading that and that's connecting with you, that makes me absolutely thrilled. It was an absolute heartbreaker to have Shirley Manson. Sorry I keep talking about her, but she's someone I really look up to.
Me too.
To have her read that and say to me, I really related to Nico. And her to say like she cried at parts reading that book, that was very difficult for me to hear. Because here's someone that I see as someone I aspire to be like in terms of how smart she is, outspoken, just everything about her. And that she feels that way was just kind of devastating to me in a lot of ways, to be honest, you know?
Yeah.
But the fact that she's feeling that way in the year 2021, we're talking about someone that died over 30 years ago with Nico, is pretty telling to the atmosphere that it is for a woman to be living in right now.
Absolutely.
I have to go in a couple of minutes, but let's tell me some, do you have any other questiones?
Wait a minute. One more quick thing. I was watching an interview with Charlie XCX and she would ask, and she was asked, what artist living or dead would you love to have a coffee with? And she was like, I just read Please Kill Me. And so I would say Iggy Pop, but I don't know if he'd have coffee. Like maybe he'd be something else, or maybe he's gone in the total opposite direction now and he's just super clean. But you are someone who has sat down with Iggy Pop. So I was just wondering if you wanted to give me a little tidbit about what that was like.
I love him. He's so wonderful and sweet and fantastic. And I adore him. And I adore his manager, Henry. Shout out to Henry. I love you, Henry. That was really great. That I got that through my friend, Danny Fields. Danny Fields actually signed the Stooges and his old friends with Iggy. So that was from Danny. Love you, Danny. And that was funny because it was actually a phone call. It was not sitting down, but it was a phone call. So I get on the phone. And one thing I really hate is when people are overly familiar if I don't know them. So Iggy gets on the phone. I'm like, hello, Mr. Pop. And I called him Mr. Pop throughout the entire interview. And he was so sweet. He said to me, he said, I've always wanted to tell one person everything that I remember about Nico. And you're that one person. He's just a doll. Like I could not have been more thankful for him. And his manager, Henry, so sweet and wonderful. I mean, wonderful, wonderful. Someone else, this is a random one. Someone else that was great was Sinead O'Connor's managers, which is, I didn't actually talk to Sinead. Excuse me. I didn't actually talk to Sinead, but her managers, I said, oh, can Sinead, I asked for Sinead to give me a quote for Britney. And Sinead had just put out her book, so she was too busy. But her managers were just really, I know it sounds weird, but like having her managers ask, like, how are you doing? How's the promo process? I'm like, these people deal with Sinead O'Connor and they're asking me how I am. Like, why do they care? Like, they were so, so sweet, you know? I love them. Just, I don't know. The Nico book, it'd be interesting to see what happens to Britney, because the Nico book, I've gotten to meet some people that I really think are great humans, like Shirley Manson, you know, Iggy. And I wonder if I'll meet other cool people. I mean, I already have Megan Radford and like the Free Britney guys are great. I wonder if I'll get to meet other cool people that I don't know already through being Britney.
Yeah. And also I love that you name dropped Danny Fields, because we stan Danny Fields in this house over here.
Oh, I love, he's coming to London soon. He sent me a text. I got it. In fact, I've not returned any of my texts from yesterday. I've got it sent about. He is one of the most wonderful, sweet, generous, fantastic humans I know. So yeah, you can stan him away. He's a wonderful, wonderful human who should be stanned.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. And tell your parents, Henry Rollins, another person that should be stanned. I love Henry Rollins with all my heart and soul.
Oh yeah. He's such a character, but he's also, you can tell, I love watching interviews with him now where you can tell that he's just such a, Henry Rollins is just such a big normie who just wants to do his normie dad stuff. And I just love it.
He's just a real friend. And like, yeah. I've never met Henry Rollins. He's like the best pen pal you can ever wish for in a million years. So you'll see, I have a video, my intern's putting up a video of me talking about Henry Rollins. So you'll see me talking about him, me just nerding out. It's about the first time I got an email from Henry Rollins. It's hilarious because nothing ever phases my husband, because he's used to me being a dork about stuff. But literally the first time I got an email from Henry Rollins, I was like, oh my God! And my husband's like, oh, that's great, honey. Like that. So yeah, it's really funny. But do me a favor and just keep in touch. Let me know when you run this so I can put it on my socials.
I will.
Okay?
I'll email you and Lizzie.
Okay, good. And if you need anything else, you let me know. Keep in touch though, okay?
Yeah, will do. Thank you so much for joining me today.
Of course. Oh, I didn't say who I was. Oh my God, I'm so sorry. I didn't say that. You get to, should I do that? Should I say who I am? You can put it in at the beginning.
Sure.
Okay. Or will you just say it?
Yeah, I'll record an intro. Like, today I chatted with Jen, and okay. who is the author of this, this, and that, and an award-winning professor. Yeah, yeah.
Okay. All right. So I'll just say thank you so much for having me, seriously, and then I'll say goodbye. Okay. Thank you so much for having me on the podcast. You are so darling and cool and cute. And thank you, all the fab listeners out there. Please pick up Being Britney, Pieces of a Modern Icon, available November 11th.
Hi, that's all. Gonna be a bestseller for sure.
I hope so. And my socials are, I'm on Instagram at just my name, Jennifer Otter Bickerdike. Thank you so much for having me on the pod.
Thank you for coming. Enjoy the rest of your day.
Okay. But seriously, keep in touch with me, okay?
Will.
Okay.
Sure.
Lots of love. Bye, sweetheart. Bye.
Bye.
Thank you for listening to Sounding Out with Izzy, and thank you to Dr. Jennifer Otter Bickerdike for joining me. Remember to subscribe to my YouTube channel. My blog is izzyshutup.com. My Instagram page is agirls2soundsense, and my Twitter is at misanthropei. Make sure to check out my Patreon and maybe subscribe. It's only $3 a month if you can. Thank you for listening once again, and I'll see you in the next episode.